there now is a pool of water no longer over heaping mud and dry. The board still hanging bare evidence of a puddle of moldy building and the pit fails from complex. Beneath the center of the exploded tile, some is garbage sheets, some is marble, fresh, working into a fine sand. Beneath the tile fabrics, copper work gathered loosely into steps in the center, radiating from the boards and becoming sparse over the middle and long floor's edge. In three cases, asymmetric respective to edges and center, the remains of three objects removed long after they are invested. The rest makes a shadow of a box-shaped depiction of a paperweight. Staples are punched into the corners of the ceiling. They pass into cotton sheets with a garish solar pattern of a fluorescent bulb in the room center, which blinks through the thread and touches the scene in a flickering light. A jungle of throw pillows and clash of patterns sprawl across the secret floor where they share a thin coating of cigarette dust. Three square iron and tables looking slightly decayed are situated at points asymmetric to edges and center. Identical in appearance, they might have been called from a larger ensemble of pumps or restaurant set. Each table is dominated by an ashtray, one of which is tipped sideways on its short pedestal and spilled its contents onto the ground. A pool of water that one time has to fill this ashtray is drawing not yet fire. In a dark room, a water tank rests sideways on a raised box-shaped platform in the center of a larger square enclosure. But once where the contents of the tank fill the larger space halfway, tiny orbs of lead rise and fall in the water. A glass mosaic lines the ground of the hole in red and gold shades, depicting birds flying in close formation. A chandelier of moving candles hangs in the ceiling center, inert. The only light which enters the room comes from a thin crack open to the outside, running across the far wall. Cold, fresh air makes its way through the fissure, tumbling down the wall and across the tile. Blood casts lightly into the mosaic enclosure in unsteady, tuberous heaps. One such cast, resembling a loose bundle of rope, teeters at the top of the stack so precarious that the slightest pressure of wind throws it off balance. As it follows the rest of the lead cast falling across the water tank to roll off of the platform and splash into the pool in the space of water over the edge of the square enclosure. It flows across the cedar floor and between the roots and branches of the frozen lead pours. Between four poured concrete walls, the tap runs into a porcelain bowl painted in a scene of birds in front, a bowl already filled, tipped toward the end of the sink. A thick stream of water spills into a growing pool on the floor, forcing a collection of crushed paper baskets outwards towards the edges of the room. Straw bones float in the cloud above them. Nested in one basket, a candle fitted into a desk lamp missing its shade throws the shadow of a bare wire across the walls. The thin line of darkness bisects the face of a young woman drinking a glass of whiskey, one of a small collection of posters placed in no particular pattern on the far wall. The candle dwindles, the wax runs down the lampside and drops into the porcelain bowl, stiffening into sinuous branches as it reaches the water's surface. In the vacancy left at the center of the drop ceiling, the water has resumed its pour. The fragments of ceiling tile expand into jagged lumps as the water touches them. Some of those papers not held down by the tile rise with the water and flow outwards towards the edges of the room. The three rust deposits begin to diffuse in the soaking paperwork, throwing red glow bubbles across the floor. The candles in the chandelier floating above the square enclosure have been set alight. Drops of wax plummet into the water beneath, either stretching into limbs as they land or encasing the lead fragments, forcing them to bob to the surface. The candles provide illumination to a wardrobe situated at the back wall. Its doors are open. Inside, a diorama constructed from paper and balsa wood. The tableau depicts a country estate. Servants stand frozen at the doors. The staples lose their hold on the ceiling and give way, each at once, so that the patterned sheet folds evenly down and covers the three black iron tables. The unveiled fluorescent light now provides its harsh glow to a newly exposed stucco ceiling. A slab projector bolted to a frame beneath the stucco has also been revealed by the fallen sheet. The projector is angled towards the scene painted on the right-hand wall and casts no light. There are trees at once and dimly sketched mountains in the background above birds flying close to formation. This room is surrounded by a ring of chairs facing inwards on all sides. The ceiling exhaust sides in the middle prepare to collapse. The stream of water pouring from the space in the center of the drop ceiling has doubled in volume. Those tiles which once held water before the center gave way on themselves, dissolving under the pressure of the leak. In the same moment, three drop and shatter onto the drowned paper. In their fall, they reveal a lead pipe through which the water flows, embedded in the pipe a fireman's axe. A square pedestal stands in the center of an assembly of chairs. A leather-bound book rests on the pedestal on its spine, wrapped at top and bottom with string. Beneath the loops, the book has been cleaved in two. The slide projector has sparked to life. Over the grass and hills, it superimposes a set of photographs and reproductions. A young woman holds a glass of whiskey to her lips and smiles at the camera. A minute passes, the slide door clicks and gives a turn. There's the antechamber of a country manor with marble floor, chandeliers, and two staircases flanked with their mouths by enormous urns, mirroring each other in their spirals upwards. The glue which holds a reproduction of an oil painting depicting a pastoral scene is softened by the heat of the lamp. Slowly it becomes unstuck and finally floats down into the flame. The strings holding the book's side shut lead away on either side of the pedestal and terminate at the legs of chairs situated opposite one another in the room. Tiny flames look at the ends of each string they blend and curl as they approach the pedestal. At two points hidden high above the paper diorama, steady trickles of sand have begun to pour. It rains across the rooftop of the paper house and piles at the feet of the servants, shortly to smother them. The flames reach the loops of string, wrapping the book's sides, and in a moment both hands fly open and reveal an illustration of some indecipherable root-like object. The design suggests a blueprint to be built from its winding upward curl and belies the possibility of such a construction ever occurring. The sheets of paperwork rise to the surface of the water as it reaches the halfway point of the room. They arrange themselves into a weird broken where the leak meets the pool. Across the pages, whose ink has begun to loosen and run, the dim outlines of doors, windows, spires, staircases. The halved pages of the book curl inward as they are consumed by fire. Ashes fly upwards in the smoke, smudge finds and print themselves in the second ceiling. The side wheel clicks and gives a turn, superimposed with their flying birds, a kind of overabundant still life. Swollen heaps of sugary pastries, huge slabs of beef and fallow, crushed grapes, eggs, mushrooms, pineapples. Fragments of ceiling rain down under the smoking pedestal, smothering the remaining fire, accumulating into a circle of debris, running outwards towards the wing of chairs. Fissures begin to snake across the ceiling, which sinks as they grow. The toaster clutches the piles of wicker light as they burn, the room fills with smoke. The tap water continues to rise, it extinguishes the fires as it nears the halfway point. Sand fills the wardrobe and obscures the paper diorama. The wardrobe's wood is unable to support the weight. Its sides bulge and then fly outwards. Sand intermixed with bits of paper flows over the mosaic, the way it took the light cast spinning it completely. The ceiling gives way, the space is filled with the contents of the room above. Only the ring of chairs remains visible around a heap of concrete, asbestos, and food which has been left to rot for months. Under the swirling dust, flattened tracks of beef, smears of geothorpe, seeds and fruits and vegetables all mingled with an overgrowth of white mold. Water presses the beams to the drop ceiling and touches the lead pipe in which it emanates. The volume is so great that the roof itself gives way and flow because the surface of the water filling the space beneath. At the balcony, reached by the winding staircase, there stands a middle-aged man dressed in a three-piece suit, cigarette in hand. He sends a stern gaze across the hall toward the camera over the hills and grass. The slide wheel clicks, gives a turn, and the projection cuts off along the fluorescent light, throwing the room into darkness. The sand becomes level with a crack, opening the door to the outside, reaching equilibrium. The chandelier is half buried, all of its candles have been snuffed out. The water has been cut off from the tap, charred wicker floats in the still pool, along with the posters which have released themselves from the concrete walls. They form an unbroken grid across the surface along which the wicker runs and bends. The hole has taken the shape of a cornucopia or a bundle of rope. As the food decomposes, so rots the rest of the room. The chairs soften and splinter. The beef becomes indistinguishable from the plaster, the ash from the vegetable. In time, over the course of centuries, the room will be a heap of the same uniform stretch of earth.